talent is at the heart of strategy because people make strategy happen. Welcome to Human Centric Podcast. What is it all about? I'm Svetlana. I'm coming from Deutsche Telekom, from the Magenta side of the world, and I work with HR with people. And I'm having a partner in crime. We have Hanne. Hanne is connecting to us from lockdown Norway, up from Oslo. And Hanne is my co-host for the show. My role in this podcast is to really pause for a second and go behind the corporate lingo. Talent management, people development, skills, technology, what do we really mean behind it? Just to pause and have a meaningful conversation. So I would say I'm the inside out agent. And Hanne, what's your role with me, my partner in crime?
Yes, I have for the last 20 years worked for a whole wide range of different organizations and companies within the corporate world, NGOs, politicians. And the topic that I've been pursuing is the idea of communication when it's live, when we try to relate and come across to other people. So the idea behind this, going beneath the surface, investigating how at the core of implementing strategies lies always, forever, the human being. You know, that it's about humans. And at the end of the day, it's about how we relate with one another. We are together, Svetlana, aren't we? Just discovering how we can get to the core of how to solve and crack the codes of how to make it happen and strive for excellence together.
So we had two pure souls in a way.
Yes, we are.
And
we certainly
I'm very happy,
are.
Yeah, I'm very happy to welcome our guests to the episode of Human Centric Podcast. And I have to say I'm thrilled and I'm excited. We have Mardia here present with us. Mardia, I have to make a confession, actually. So if I would make a short list of people I want to have lunch with, you would be on my short list.
Thank you.
I think Mardia is really an inspiring agent of DT who talks a lot about people, human side, and the skills for the future, and what we have to do to change inside Deutsche Telekom to get there. So Mardia, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm really honored to be here with you today.
Thanks for that, Mardia. I think I just have to say straight away, I got so curious when I looked, I think it was on your LinkedIn page, and you have like this headline and it says technology for good. And I was like, yes to that, but I was like, technology for good purposes? Or tell me more about it. What lies behind those words for you?
You know, I'm thinking a lot about companies and the kind of things that we do and the track record we leave in society. And I think it's a moral dilemma that faces a lot of companies. Does the products or the services that we offer harm people in any way? And you know, it's a discussion that's quite current when you have technology that could be used to distort facts. If you have products that make people addicted to sugar, or children to smoking. You know, it's these kind of topics that we need to think about, because technology in itself, of course, is not good or bad, but it's how we use this. And for me, it's really important in the work that I do, and especially in choosing the company that I work for, to know that it's a company that has a responsibility, that will not do anything to harm people, but that will use the power of this technology that they have for good purpose and really to do the right thing in the world that we are living in.
Absolutely.
Svetlana, that's so interesting. I think the idea of technology actually being neutral, but at the same time it's being filled with what we as humans can fill it with, because we are, at least for now, the ones creating the artificial intelligence. We're going to go more into that, but I think it's definitely we are at a point where we can discuss moral issues to do with the creations that we're creating out there and how they actually impact the world around us. And that could lead me to Borislav, couldn't it, straight away? Because Borislav, on your LinkedIn page, I think it was, there's actually another headline. I don't know if you guys planned this together, but your headline just says, do something great.
True.
So, lovely to meet you and have you on the program, Borislav. Tell us about that headline.
Same here, yeah. So I'm in a really in a beautiful, both virtually and physically, in an amazing group. I have to say, I'm really proud that I can share this stage with three extremely successful women and speaking about the technology and the talent. So do something great is something that really I strive to. Every day, and I'm not speaking about great things, only about those things which are really so sustainable that they last for centuries. You know, my personal opinion is that we, all of us, yeah, people, individuals, groups, we need to try or strive to leave the world behind, which is a bit better than the one which we were born into. And independent of female or male, I think everyone wants to leave a trace, you know, something, some kind of small legacy. And as that legacy can be then improved or used for good, I think that's the best possible legacy. So it can be as good or as great as Nikola Tesla inventing, you know, AC. Yeah. Or on the other hand, it could also be someone like. Basically, someone helping someone over the street, and especially if that kind of help is a technology helping a blind person crossing over the street, then that's also something great that we should all do.
It's we can notice how the commercial forces are, of course, some of the strongest forces on the planet, and the idea of actually using those forces for something good it seems like it's not. Only in your company, but also in loads of other companies I visit these days, that's becoming not only introduced, but it's becoming like self-explanatory. Mm. It's at the actual core. And that is certainly a change, isn't it? If we look back some decades, if you look at like the ice cold capitalism that used to be there, seems to be a change.
Absolutely, Hannah. And relating to the topic that we're talking about, Svetlana, around talent, is that a lot of the younger people that we all try to reach out to, they are very interested in doing purposeful work and not just in something that makes money. Of course, that's also important for people.
Make an impact.
But it's really about making an impact. Mm. So for me, that links very well to this topic as well, to what are the kind of people that we are looking for eventually that will come into our organizations.
Oh, that's lovely. Mm. So the idea that if we are looking to attract enthusiastic, idealistic people from the generations that we see coming out into the workforce now, you really are nowhere unless you can actually prove that you are trying to do something for good. Is that,
absolutely. It's basically a common impulse. I've noticed it in a Stanford group, alumni group, people who are dealing with artificial intelligence. We did that a year ago, and it is amazing. It's like basically a global group of some 30 people with very different backgrounds and different both in the context of what they are doing, in context where they are coming from. And I think 2 days after the corona pandemic started or was officially announced worldwide, and the first lockdown, 2 days after, we already discussed in the group how can we leverage artificial intelligence, for example, in order to help stopping spreading of or saving people's lives. And one of the ideas was, let's analyze the cough samples, because we knew that's one of the symptoms of corona. Let's analyze if it's a dry cough. We cannot hear it by our own ears, but artificial intelligence based on the samples can extrapolate what the infected person is and what not. Yeah. And the funny thing is, we discussed it, we made a couple of rounds around it, and then several months later, I think 2 months before today's date, it was officially announced that I think MIT really made the software or finalized the idea that we have this cough analysis. Mm. So yes, it can be, and it should be for a good purpose. Mm. We can all contribute to that.
Oh, totally. Svetlana, I'm so aware that we're in two different studios. Is there something on your mind? Something you want to say?
You know, I'm thinking a lot, and these days when we try to also uncover this inside gig of telecom. So we work in a big corporation, we have many people inside. And you mentioned technology for good, and you know, it's developing so rapidly, AI is coming in. So I'm always thinking around two points in here. First, how can we keep up to date with what's happening? Mm. Because how can I, you know, be continuously upgraded as software to stay up to date? Yeah. If you have any good hints and tips for people, how to really not be ashamed of that or scared of that, because it's actually scary. Yeah. To see what it's is developing here.
It's really scary, Svetlana, and you know, we're talking in Deutsche Telekom specifically at the moment a lot about this topic, about how do I remain current with my skills, because I think the one thing that is clear is that no company can any longer promise a job for life. But what we could do is to say we will support you to be employable wherever, whenever. All of the research that we are reading at the moment, the World Economic Forum's latest research that was just published a few weeks ago, McKinsey, all of these consulting companies, everywhere you go, you will read that anywhere between a third of the world's working population up to 50% of people need to upgrade their skills. But it starts by you admitting that there is something to learn. So this is why the whole topic of learning new things is a deep cultural topic, where people should not be afraid to put their hand up and say, you know what, I would like to do some more training. I'd like to change direction. And I do believe that this will be the most critical topic that is facing us as organizations in the next 10 years, I believe.
And that this is a perfect segue, isn't it, Svetlana? Because when Svetlana and I were planning for this episode today, we were having this conversation and saying, like, you know, because unless you know the facts and the figures, you're kind of sitting there with this feeling these days of like, oh my God, artificial intelligence is coming. How quickly is it coming? When will I be replaced? You know, and
will I be replaced?
I, of course, won't be replaced, but you know, we're frightened for our kids. The idea of knowing how to actually meet it, if we are, like Svetlana's saying here, if the human beings, if we look at ourselves as software for a second, we're definitely software, not hardware, huh? If we are software, what kind of upgrade is actually needed? I think maybe you're pointing to one thing, Mardia, straight away when you're saying one thing that is needed is our attitude towards learning new things needs to change in itself. Is that the correct interpretation?
Absolutely. You know, I think the challenge is that, you know, many people, when you look at average companies, and I'm just, you know, talking about Germany at the moment because this is where I am at the moment, but you look at the average age of our employees and you look at, it's probably 25 years ago that most people have actually been to university or studied something. And that cannot be any longer. You know, it cannot be that 25 years ago you got very valuable education. That is not enough to carry you into the next 25 years. Because the other thing that is reality is people are also getting older. So we're also working for longer in different kind of formats. So so we need to upskill. And one of the interesting bits of research as well is that the life cycle of your knowledge is getting shorter and shorter. You know, so if you learn something new today, it does not mean that now you have it for the next 10 years. It's actually about 5 years. Then there's the next cycle that needs to come. Boris, you also wanted to say something.
Absolutely, I absolutely agree. You know, I was asking myself a personal question. I was my grandfather, mother's father was an engineer. Yeah, so my dad was an engineer. Yeah, so and I was always trying to ask myself as an engineer myself, what is the common thing which combines three of us? You know, my grandpa at the beginning of the last century, my dad, you know, in the he was born in the 50s, and myself, you know, being born in the 80s, and I can tell you that as what connects the engineers from all three ages is, on one hand, exactly this readiness for continuous learning and development, you know, self-triggered, self-passionately to drive yourself to improve in the various domains. Whether it's 100 years ago, it was reading, it was listening, learning from your master, like my grandpa did before he went with 12 to be an electrician in the mines, you know, digging, you know, they were digging coal, so he needed to electrify that. So that was his, and then later he was electrician on the submarine, one of the first ones in Europe. And then basically after that, my dad, and as a traffic engineer developing infrastructure, traffic infrastructure, I was thinking like, with me as a software developer originally, now of course for the last 15 years I was more or less in leadership positions, not so much dealing with the programming itself, but I have to say what connects us was definitely this continuous urge from the times to read, to go to the conferences, digital or at the time physical, to expand your network, and this network not only to leverage it for your let's say for your benefits in context of a career or something, but also to learn from that network, from the diverse people in that network, to leverage that, and to keep an open mind, you know? Not to say, I didn't hear my grandpa, I met him, and of course we had like, I think my first 20 years of my life, I was very close to him before he passed away. And I can tell you, one of the things he always told me, like, you know, like it's simply, in my time, you know, I learned this technology and this kind of technique, you know, and my dad said, he said, like, your dad also learned this new method, but the thing is, we kept an open mind for the new technologies, and like you, Maria, said perfectly, in 5 years, who knows what we're going to have, you know, like, I can remember still things I was personally learning at the university at software. I was proud back then, like, knowing 30 programming languages. I can tell you, from those 30, I think only five are survived. With modifications are relevant today.
Yeah. So,
and it was not long ago. It was basically a couple of years ago. So this is a really a huge, huge need to keep an open mind, to continuously learn and develop, and basically to be proactive, not to expect that the company or the universities will just shove you, give you something in your hands and say, do that, but just to use all the opportunities you have.
So I love this point. So to try and kind of bottom line what we're saying here, coming into work every day and just doing what you did yesterday
is not good enough.
Is no longer gonna cut it. That to me brings, again, so we're on this level of like, what mindset do I need to have to be a talent in any organization these days? And what you're pointing to is that the mindset I need to bring needs to be pretty resilient to change. I need to be what? I need to be able to throw away the ideas of yesterday without falling apart or going, oh my God, all the stuff I knew is gone. Yeah. And I need to be able to embrace learning new stuff. Am I right?
Yeah. And I think the other reality is that as a company, we are finding that our industry is changing so rapidly that the kind of skills that we need, one, we don't have it in the company because we didn't focus early enough on some of that learning. We are now, and we have done since the last 2 years. But we need, you know, it's enormous time that it will take to make sure that we are there. And then when you go and look outside for these skills, you will find that you don't have the classic competitors any longer. You know, so it's not if you're in the telco industry that you only have the Vodafones or you know, any of these companies to worry about. Every single company now, all the GAFAs, small startups need data scientists. They need software developers. So the whole world is moving to that space. So suddenly that skill is needed everywhere. And we are competing everywhere for these skills. So we need to find the solution internally as well. Of course, it will not only come from that, but I think the one thing that we are realizing is more and more we are realizing nearly 50% of the gap in skills will have to come through reskilling or upskilling. And this is, for me, the challenge that we are facing, Boris, in this, especially in this becoming a softwareized telco.
Absolutely.
And in our kind of industry specifically.
Absolutely. And the great example is also the change which is happening within the network technology, you know, like switching people who are working mostly with copper-based technologies for years and decades. Yeah, now suddenly we are focused on FTTH, fiber to the home, and basically everyone needs to learn these new technologies. And basically, there are not many profiles which will remain the same in the future. Yeah, so there were some people who knew both technologies and were dealing either their technicians, you know, or people who are monteurs, or people who are doing the planning and documentation process. However, in every part of the value chain, there's something new. There's a new tool, there is a new system, there's a new technology or new method, which let's say adds speed or lowers the cost. Then there's aspect of doing physically the work. You know, that for me, switching from the IT where I started basically in Deutsche Telekom over different functions then to NetNT, I can tell you I was scared as hell thinking like, what do I know about splicing or about, you know, digging or so. And I of course had to look at my more experienced colleagues from the other regions and the other parts of technology to learn from them. But I can tell you, I've seen so many great people in the organization, independent of their grade and level, which perfectly developed and acquired these new skills in a short time. They were simply not afraid. They said, I'm magenta, you know, like I will make it. And they did it. And it's
okay.
And it's
I'm going
transition.
To I'm going to barge in there, Boris, and just remind us that, you know, we are in Deutsche Telekom. That's what we're visiting here. And the idea of the industry you're describing, like the copper based and the 5G and all of this terminology coming out, is of course your journey at this moment in time. And the telecom industry for sure is one of the, like, the industries on the planet, like, in major change right now. Am I right?
It's massive. I mean, we, you know, with the whole implementation of a network disaggregation strategy, it opened an entire new area of skills. Cloudification skills, automation skills. We kind of, when we looked at the kind of skills, we divided it in different groups, the kind of skills that we need here. And the first group was a group of facilitator skills. And these are skills like scrum masters, design thinking experts, or design thinking coaches, release train engineers. And these are the kind of skills that we need more of to guide the organization through an agile journey. And this could be in specifically in the IT space, but also in any of the other spaces where we conduct huge projects. Then we've got the engineering roles, which is where we see massively software engineering, data scientists, DevOps engineers, experience designers, more and more. You know, if we are customer facing in the way that we want to make fans of customers. We are saying in Germany now, and we really, really want to make sure that we understand and that we increase the experience of our customer. Then we need these people with this kind of skill, which is now in huge demand. And the third is something that you alluded to, which is around architecture roles. You know, what are these kind of, it's decoupling, it's APIs. Sorry, Anna, I have to mention this, but, you know, and it's microservices, you know, that, and it's this, how do we build this architecture to ensure that we become this softwareized telco? So it can be overwhelming at times.
And what I'm hearing, Marzia, when you're saying that, you know, software-based telco, leading European telco, and all those technical skills we need to have for the future, actually, are we really becoming expertise-driven company more than we, you know, we were more leadership-driven, you know, where leadership are front-end. The more and more we talk, the more I see the experts, you know, they need to shine for experts. Would you agree to that?
Yes, I mean, it's a great, and it has to be blend, you know. It's interesting what we are blending currently. We are blending our experts, people who have long-term experience in different things, like, let's say, IT planning, network planning, project management, software development, etc., with people who have skills which we need in order to make our customers to the fans. And I think it's a fantastic idea and the vision. And with the third thing, which is automation, AI, and everything else. So basically the third kind of, let's say, actors in this game. And I think it's very important that we enable the people to embrace that. You know, when I'm looking about how we are planning in, say, in a year, I expect latest in a year, we'll be done with our FTTH factory, which will enable us to automate the planning and the documentation process and many other steps in our value chain, building, you know, getting our fiber optics to the customer. Up to now, it was done manually, you know, not with a pen and pencil, but with the, you know, like people sitting in front of the documentation or planning systems, GIS, doing that manually. So now they're asking themselves, I'm a great talent, I'm a great expert. What do I do next? What's my next step, you know? And we explain them, look, whenever whatever the machine produces, whatever the robot produces, it'll be, of course, faster and it'll be higher and better in scale, but still some things you have to correct, some things you have to do a quality assurance with, some things you have to strategically, like you mentioned, Mardia, you have to strategically look at and think, is this something that we need to adapt, or how can we adapt this so that it's even better for the customer? Yeah. Because you know, machine, let's say mapping an area when it passes a building, doesn't know that that building might be an orphanage or might be a senior home where we need to make sure that the connection, especially now in Corona times, is enabled so that they can communicate with the families or outside world. So that's exactly where this human intelligence comes in and blends these three different profiles.
Yeah. So I just to answer on that as well. So we need obviously these real great experts. But then you have to put the human-centeredness there. Yeah. You have to still look at what is it, you know, what is the interpretation? And every single person actually within the company needs to understand that they have to ask these kind of questions of what value do I add in this process?
Yeah.
So even if I'm in a corporate function or a support function, this doesn't mean we don't need anyone who are not a super technical expert. But for example, in HR, we need people who understand data analytics and who understands what to do with that and can ask the so what questions. So it is everybody of us, you know, in our areas need to add this little bit of technology expertise together with the whole experience of empathy, of listening, of understanding what a customer wants.
So technology is no longer a function. It's something that unites, in a way, the whole company together, right?
Hannah's desperately trying to say something, but
jump in.
That's fine. I'm super fascinated by your conversation. Trying to look at this from the outside in, you strike me as now a company at the very, very peak of like exploring the potential of the new technologies coming into the corporate world. And at the same time, you are right now pointing to all the human mindsets and skills and perspectives that still seem to be needed. And if I understand you, Mardia, correctly, you're saying that it's the blend, also Boris, you're saying it too, it's the in the mix, it's in the cross-functional, expertise field in the mix. That's where the exciting stuff happens. Exactly. Say more about that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just around leadership, Hannah, because you can now, obviously, I think the classic role of just being the head of, pulling everything together and then just passing it on to someone else, there will be less of those jobs. There's no doubt about that. But the way that we lead in this new world is fundamentally different. So there's a huge group of people called leaders who needs to lead in a very, very different way, who has to have the ability to bring all these topics together, who even just something simple, well, not simple, as catastrophic as the pandemic has been. This has caused massive challenges for leaders. How do you lead with people working so virtually? How do you connect? Because in the end, a lot of the work that we did, of course, we were able to do virtually and obviously from your home office. But that human interaction, that engagement, that sharing of, okay, so this is the target that we are going for. What is the feedback that I'm getting? Am I on track still? Are we changing something? Those kind of conversations have to happen in a new way and in a different way. And this is so when we talk upskilling or reskilling, we talk everybody. We have at the moment, we are saying that every single employee in Deutsche Telekom has to do or has to have a personal learning journey, which you need to look at in terms of your own, where you come from, what you're doing, what you want to do next, that needs to be put together because none of us will be untouched.
Exactly.
On this journey.
It sounds like you're describing a journey where sitting back and being passive is no longer a possibility.
Yeah. And that for me is the danger, Hannah, is that we actually, the research that we've seen now is that around 75% of companies are offering opportunities to employees, you know, for learning, for upskilling, for training. But we only see an uptake of about 40%. And I'm seeing it personally still. We have the first movers, and I'm very proud of those guys. I have to say so to everybody who jumped into the first academies. I'm so proud of them because it was hard. They had to leave because these were academies that were said, I'm leaving my current job. I'm going into a new job that I don't really know. I don't even know what it's going to be. So there are people for sure that are prepared to do that. But unfortunately, we don't have everybody there yet. We don't have everybody really.
I would be really curious. Do you have any age demographics there? Do you have any, like who are the ones who are actually doing it?
Well, it's a mix, actually, Hannah. It's a mix. It's interesting. We are obviously, as far as companies go, we're a slightly more mature company, if I can say it like that. So we, so generally, so I must say what I found in our groups of people who went for the data analytics and the software academy, they were mature people. So it was a mix between young and older.
Oh, hooray.
So we didn't find that it was only the younger people that didn't know. But we will have to find a way to connect to people that they understand the challenge that will come our way if we don't jump into these opportunities.
Exactly. And we need to serve as an example. That's I'm really convinced in that I cannot move several thousand people in my organization if I just tell them, please go and do the online courses, do the upskilling, go to the programs. I have to show by myself and my leadership team, of course, that we are also taking regular qualification programs and measures, that we are also improving ourselves on a daily or weekly or monthly basis before I can, let's say, sell that to the people, and it's very important that we start, and we are then through that more trustworthy, as we say, what's our personal development journey, and how do we then correlate that with the success of the rest of the organization, where are our gaps, and we have a great corporation there, we know our gaps, and we know our demographic structure, so we know what we have to do, we just need to enable this, both by example, and then, of course, giving space. Let's not forget, coming now from the operational business, that very often the employees are asking, when will I do it? Yes. When I look at my tasks, if difficult. I do them from, 7 in the morning until 7 in the evening, I will still be overbooked.
Exactly.
So when do I go and take, let's say, 1 or 2 or 5 days for the training? And we as leaders, as an organization, need to enable them so that they can participate in upskilling and reskilling programs.
Absolutely
Boris,
critical.
I love what you're saying there. I have to ask it to you straight away. What was your last learning initiative? What did you do for yourself?
Actually, I did shop floor management. Shop floor is one method within the lean management approach, which we are introducing now in the factory. And yes, I got it from the management summaries and everything. And I said, of course I can do it. Like the typical, sovereign, I can do it. But on the other hand, then I said, no. Yes, I know it from the slides, but I want to experience it. I want to go through the simulation of the shop floor talks. So honestly, it was extremely hard, I have to say, to carve out 3 Mondays. I think I did 3 Mondays, 3 hours, which is in this year really a luxury. I carved them out. Yes, I was a bit distracted, but I was proud of myself at the end for being able to go with. I was sitting there with the experts, with people from the organization from different regions. It was not hierarchy based, from every old levels. And honestly, I participated in discussion, and through that, not only that I learned about the shop floor management method, which is actually quite exciting, to method I can suggest it to every operational unit, but also what I learned is what the people think about this upskilling, what the people think about the method, so that I can apply that, in order to improve the organization and in order to improve the introduction of this method in the organization. So I can warmly recommend that. But honestly, if I would be fair to myself, I should have done more. I should have done some other trainings this year, but somehow Corona came by.
And it's I'm just
sorry,
to build on that. In terms of why people not 100% yet applying, you have a queue for people rolling into that. I think it's difficult. The human side about that. It's actually scary.
Svetlana, just on that topic, we looked at that when we chose this first group of people to go to become software engineers. Now you have to know this is people who have never done programming in their life before. Now they went on this program. It was a full-time 6 months and then some project work. And the biggest thing that we discovered, you must remember, when I'm, say, 45 years old, I've built my career in Deutsche Telekom, and I was successful at a middle management layer or at a team leader level in my previous role. So I've earned my bread with that. People recognized me as an expert. Now I'm stepping into a world where I will be a beginner. Because when you come out of this training, you are just a beginner. I mean, when you talk about software development, there's back end, front end, there's so many different specialities that you need to go into. So people feel they come out of that and they're a beginner. And that's quite a big topic to get your your head around. And you need to make peace with that. And that's quite a big thing that I think stands in the way of people jumping into that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. Maybe if just to add one
if
point.
If I can interpret the conversation, then the direction we're taking now, part of what you're saying, Mardia, is that when I have a long CV or a long track record in one field, that's going to feel somehow like leverage. It's going to feel like I have some like status.
Yeah.
Yes. And then all of a sudden now I have to let that go and feel like a baby again.
Yes.
That would be very scary in itself.
Yeah.
And then I just wanted to go back to Boris. I think it's so lovely put what you're saying, that not only do we have to role model, but actually we need to know what it's like as leaders now. We need to know what it's like from the inside to do these learning programs and understand the new stuff. And that brings me to one fact, because that's what I find when I try to do the same, try to challenge myself. I try to like learn new things all the time. And sometimes it's really hard.
It is.
Learning is hard. Mm. And like you said, it comes up against prioritizing and our busy lives and wanting to do a good job, even.
Hannah, don't forget one point which Mardia said, which is extremely important and not easy problem to solve. Many people who are successful in their roles, independently of whether they are team heads or even senior experts or something, or then later executives, what they have sometimes as a topic is a dignity or ego or something. It's not a problem in the sense of like that it's pathological. It's just a problem that someone, like you said, has to be a beginner. So how did we try to tackle that? Yeah. So is to see if we brand it as an official training where you start as a beginner or you end as a total expert. Some people would say, why would I go through that? You know, that would be under my level or under my dignity, you know? But if we say, look, this is an interesting opportunity, go there, because there's lots of ways how we can learn in non-formal environments from the people, through peers, going into the, for example, discussions outside of also the telecom, within tech community, engineer communities, etc., or mint associations. And if we give them that, they will be more open, because they'll see, okay, there's no like typical development path, but there is a clear impulses I can reach and win from these kind of discussions. And up to now, they were quite positive, you know?
I would take it even one step further, and I would say that the old-fashioned role of the I know a lot of stuff because I'm an expert, because I've been doing one thing for 20 years. That character has kind of gone out the window now, isn't it?
It's over.
To be replaced by, oh my Lord, I don't understand very much, but I'm just trying as hard as I can to keep up.
Yeah.
Right? There's a new mindset in there.
Constant journey, lifelong journey, forever.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think this is a really good phrase to sum up our conversation, because I think what I took for myself out of this, you know, human-centric conversation, that it's a lifelong learning, it's for the lifetime, it's continuously changing. You have to really continue to learn and learn how to learn and unlearn. And it's not easy. And we as an organization have to support that process for our people who are spending time with us in DT. We are building up a talent hub, which is the new approach to talent management. We want to have more discussions about what it means for technical talent, what it means for commercial, for leadership, for support functions, and how we are changing in here. It's very easy to check out what Talent Hub is all about. It's available on Yum. Just, you know, type Talent Hub. And we also will be sharing more experiences and more insights externally as well. Thank you very much, Boris. Thank you very much, Mardia. It felt like 1 minute,
I have to say.
It was a pleasure.
It was a good conversation.
Nice to meet you.
Hannah, very nice to meet you as well, Hannah. Very nice.
Nice regards to Oslo. Yeah.
Yeah. Stay safe.
Stay safe. Stay safe.
This podcast is brought to us by Code and Design at Deutsche Telekom. Have a look out for the Human Centric Podcast.